Okay, thank you, and welcome to the third meeting of 2023 and session six of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, with no apologies this morning. So our first agenda item is to ask to agree to take item six, which is consideration of today's budget evidence in private. Are we agreed?
Yes.
Okay, that's good, thank you. Our next item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the draft first-tier tribunal for Scotland, transfer of functions of the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel, Regulations 2023. And I welcome to the meeting Elena Whitham, MSP, Minister for Community Safety and her officials, Lisa Davidson, Civil Justice Senior Policy Officer, and Martin Brown, Solicitor, Legal Directorate in the Scottish Government, and I refer members to paper one. And invite the Minister to speak to the draft instrument. Minister.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Members. The regulations before you are the First-Tier Tribunal for Scotland Transfer of Functions of Council Tax Reduction Review Panel, Regulations 2023. These regulations will, if passed, transfer the functions of the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel into the Scottish Tribunal structure created by the Tribunal Scotland Act of 2014. The 2014 Act created a new simplifying statutory framework for tribunals in Scotland by establishing the Scottish Tribunals, which brings together existing tribunal jurisdictions together and provides a structure for new jurisdictions. The functions of the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel, Valuation Appeals Committees and certain functions of the Lands Tribunal for Scotland are to be transferred into the Scottish Tribunals on the 1st of April 2023. The regulations covering the transfer of the Valuation Appeals Committee and Lands Tribunals for Scotland were considered at a previous meeting of the committee. The instrument before you for consideration today is the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Transfer Functions of Council Tax Reduction Review Panel Regulations 2023. The Council Tax Reduction Scheme provides lower income households with a reduction in their council tax liability. An applicant who is unhappy with a local authority decision in relation to council tax reduction can ask for a review. If they are still unhappy following the review, they can apply to the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel for a review of the local authority decision. These regulations transfer the existing functions of the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel to the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Local Taxation Chamber and abolish the Council Tax Reduction Review Panel. Going forward, appeals of local authority decisions in relation to council tax reduction will be heard by the First Tier Tribunal Local Taxation Chamber. The regulations also make consequential amendments to primary and secondary legislation resulting from the transfer of functions into the Scottish Tribunals. I understand that the DPLR Committee considered these regulations on the 10th of January 2023. The DPLR Committee identified an incorrect cross-reference in the regulations. The incorrect cross-reference is an error. Officials have proposed that the instrument is amended prior to signing to correct the erroneous reference. The DPLR Committee noted the proposal for rectifying the error and agreed that the instrument should be drawn to the attention of the Parliament on the general reporting ground. And I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. It's always good to see the DPLR Committee doing its work so diligently. These are often very technical matters, and it's good that the process works. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and your officials. I note from the submissions from CPAG that they believe that they welcome, obviously, claimants being able to make challenges to their council tax reduction through the tribunal system, but they suggested that actually putting it in the first-tier tribunal for social security would be a more appropriate place. Has the government considered that? And why did they not make amendments to the regulations with that regard?
Yeah, thanks for that question, Pam Duncan-Glancy. And yes, the government was very aware of CPAG's response during the consultation process. I think if we think back to the United Kingdom's Welfare Reform Act of 2012, which abolished council tax benefit, that removed the support for council tax from the benefit system, and in response, the Scottish Government introduced the Council Tax Reduction Scheme, which creates a schedule of means-tested reduction to an individual's council tax liability. I think it's important to point out that council tax reduction is not a benefit, and it's not a benefit that is administered by Social Security Scotland, which the Social Security Chamber actually deals with. What it does do is it reduces applicants' liability for council tax. And it was a matter of policy that the decision was made that all appeals relating to local council tax, including council tax reduction, should be heard by the local taxation chambers as being issues relating to local taxation. I think it's important that we do note that officials and government, when drawing this up, actually were very mindful of the complexities round about council tax reduction and the people who maybe are going to be bringing those cases into the local taxation chamber. And I don't know if either of the officials want to elaborate a little bit on that. Lisa?
Yeah, I'm happy to say a few words anyway. Some of the aspects that we took into account is the obligation to treat people coming before the tribunal in accordance with the overriding objectives. I think that's set out in the regulations you'll be looking at after us, I think. But the overriding objective requires that people are treated fairly in the course of the tribunal proceedings, and that would be the case whatever chamber it came into, but also in relation to council tax reduction in particular. We took steps in the procedures to ensure that if there were failure to comply with the rules for any reason, that that could be that wouldn't be the end of proceedings, that that could be forgiven in certain circumstances. So in line with what was just said, we took into account those concerns as those things were being drafted up. Is there anything else you want to add to that, Lisa?
Is there anything to add? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'm content with that description and answer. On the basis of doing so, then what can the government set out in terms of training or support that will be provided to the members who sit on the tribunal that this has been allocated to understand some of the complexities? Whilst I appreciate what's been said around social security and that this is a council tax reduction, not a benefit, and I appreciate that. Thank you for it. What specific support have they been given to understand the complexities that some families may experience as part of that?
Yeah, thank you, Pat Duncan Clancy, for that further question. I think it's a very probing question and one that requires a good answer. I think that those that are going to be transferring, the members that are already existing, there's going to be several that are going to be transferring into the local taxation chamber that are going to carry that really good working knowledge that they have with them. And there's a thorough training package that's in place for any new members of a chamber, regardless of which chamber that would be. But with regards to this, I think that that is something that we will absolutely make sure that people that are appointed to the chamber understand the very issue that you have raised and the complexities round about the cases that come, and where that needs an element of discretion and understanding in dealing with those to make sure that people actually get the access to justice that they're looking for.
Thank you. I have no further questions.
Thank you. And Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here and thank you for the answers. My question is along exactly the same lines as Pam Duncan Glancy's. I suppose just a final point on that. If I take what you say about the training and the support that those officers will have, if they will there be an opportunity for them, if they identify a potential issue, to not advise but suggest, I suppose, signpost the people who are before them to seek further support or advice from Social Security Scotland, because they may identify in the information that they've got, they may identify opportunities for benefits perhaps that those individuals are not claiming, even though they are eligible for them. And I'm just wondering about how we close the circle between what is, as you say, a taxation system with the Social Security that should be there to provide support.
Yeah, thanks Maggie Chapman for that question. I think it's important that we recognise that this tribunal chamber will not be dealing with anybody's underlying entitlement to anything, but I think the signposting element of anybody's work is really important, and that's something that perhaps I need to come back to the committee with an answer to, a fulsome answer to that. But I'm definitely hearing what you've said and also what Pam Duncan Glancy said round about that.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a communication thing, isn't it? It's making sure people are aware of what's out there. So, thank you.
Okay, thank you. No further questions or comments. Okay, that being the case, we'll move straight on to item 3, which is the formal business in relation to the statement. And to move the motion for approval of the affirmative instrument. So I invite the Minister to move the motion S6M07224.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. Do you have any members have any further comments? Okay, that being the case, are we all agreed? Okay, we are all agreed. So that concludes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I thank the Minister and our officials for attending The clerks will do a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we've considered today. If you can just get agreement for that, that's great. In that case, thanks very much, Minister and officials. We'll pause briefly before we move to the next item. Thank you. We'll move on to item four, which is consideration of two negative SSIs. The First Tier Tribunal for Scotland Local Taxation Chamber Rules of Procedure Regulations 2022 and the Upper Tribunal for Scotland Regulations 2022. And I refer members to paper two. Do you have any members have any comments to make on either of these instruments? Okay, that being the case, there will be no reporting from those instruments, which are negative. So thanks. We'll now move on to item five, and I'll suspend the meeting briefly to allow the Minister and officials to take their place at the table. Thank you. Thank you. So we'll resume with item five on our agenda, which is Budget Scrutiny 2023-24. I refer members to paper three and welcome to the meeting Christina McKelvey, Minister for Equalities and Older People. And the Minister is accompanied by Rob Priestley, Head of Mainstreaming and Strategy Unit in the Directorate for Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights, and Ben Walsh, Head of Budget Improvement at the Scottish Exchequer. So I invite the Minister to provide an opening statement before we move to questions from the committee. Minister.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone, and thank you for inviting me to the second budget scrutiny session. I always welcome the opportunity to give further evidence to the committee on one of the most challenging budget rounds since devolution. 2022 was an exceptional year for public finances. Throughout, we focused on analysing the equality implications of budget decisions. In May, we published an Equality and Fairer Scotland analysis of the resource spending review. And in November, we published an Equality and Fairness evidence summary alongside the emergency budget review. And in December, we published our Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement alongside our main budget document. So a busy few months. The Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement sets out how the government has assessed the impact that the budget makes on equality and fairness and how these considerations influence our budget decisions. It's a vital piece of the budget jigsaw, a complicated jigsaw, helping to ensure that we both understand the impacts of budget decisions and have the relevant analysis to support the difficult decisions that we must take. Over the last decade, we have worked to continuously refine and improve our processes, remaining committed to embedding the principles of transparency, participation and accountability within these. And these improvements have been recognised by our stakeholders, including the Equality Human Rights Commission and the Scottish Women's Budget Group. These stakeholders welcomed the inclusion of more detailed analysis by portfolio and protected characteristic. I really welcome stakeholders' continued help in pointing to further areas of improvement. And I listened to some of the committee last week and took some notes on some of the proposals then. We will continue to work on these areas, drawn on the expert guidance of the Equality Human Rights Budgetary Advisory Group and its chair. I know you had here last week, Professor Angela Hagan. I was really pleased to note that she commented on the significant improvements in the multiple documents that are part of the budget suite during her evidence last week. And I'm meeting with her in February, and we will be discussing our forthcoming formal response to the recommendations made by the Equality and Human Rights Budgetary Advisory Groups. And I'll update the committee on that when we get that. So we remained absolutely committed to advancing equality and human rights through our continued financial support for organisations who work with disadvantaged people throughout Scotland, such as the Glasgow Afghan United. And last week, I was hosted by Glasgow Afghan United at their Burns and Rumi supper night. Glasgow Afghan United, who are supported by the Scottish Government funding, are one of our partners in delivering the new Scotch strategy. They do incredible work, and if you've not seen the work that they do, please go and have a look at it. But most recently, they were a partner in the Afghanistan relocation and resettlement schemes, helping people relocate to Scotland from Afghanistan. We're also providing up to £1.5 million for the establishment of a race observatory on ethnicity and racial inequalities, providing a range of functions in relation to anti-racism. It's a significant step towards bringing about systemic change to help create equity in Scotland's communities. This is just one part of our £48.9 million commitment to work with and with Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights Directorate. And this includes, and I'll just give you a quick list of some of the things, it includes £19 million per year to support our 100 organisations to eradicate, over 100, 112 organisations, I think it is, to eradicate violence against women and girls through our Delivering Equally Safe funding. £971,000 emergency winter funding package to tackle social isolation and loneliness. We've just announced that this week. And £205,000 of funding to Age Scotland to help keep the doors open for older people's community groups. And I know that was something that many MSPs were concerned about, the report they published at Christmas. Dedicated funding to ensure that the consultation on the forthcoming Human Rights Bill is as inclusive and wide-reaching as possible. And we're working with many key partners on that. The money we are investing will also contribute to both our short and long-term goals. Short-term, I'm focusing on the implementation of the Hate Crime Act 2021, prioritising funding for violence against women and girls, progressing the National Advisory Council for Women and Girls recommendations, legislating to end conversion practices, implement the Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund, furthering the work of the Interim Governance Group to develop anti-racism infrastructure, and progressing engagement with our faith and belief groups on our new strategy for that. We cannot do any of this in isolation, convener, so I also want to implement effective and fair grant funding approaches to our third sector partners, and I've also worked to increase the pace and effectiveness of mainstreaming. That's why Rob's with us today, supporting the embedding of equality and human rights. And it's only by working across government and the public sector that we can create real change. As I said earlier, we have had to make some difficult decisions this year in relation to the budget. And government has a duty to direct our limited funding to where it can have the most positive effect on people to advance equality and human rights. And we remain committed to doing so. I will continue to listen to the diverse needs. I don't make any decisions in my portfolio, convener, without speaking to stakeholders and folk who are impacted, but seeking to create meaningful and lasting change in this space. And I look forward to the year ahead and continue to work with the committee on many of the issues that I have on my agenda. And I'm happy to take questions, convener.
Superb. Thanks very much. And thanks for that slightly wider introduction there. And we may have one or two questions around some of the wider matters. But first of all, obviously, we want to focus on the budget. And one of the themes that came up in our early pre-budget meetings with stakeholders and also the meeting yesterday was about accessibility to the budget and for instance, easy-read versions. And there was, I think, last week in particular, we heard just how welcome the Your Scotland, Your Finances document was. But there was a little concern that that document, which did make the budget much more understandable, more accessible to more people, wasn't available at the same time the budget was launched. And I just wonder if you might be able to comment on that, and maybe Rob can give us a little flavour of what work's going on to try and make sure that at all times when these kind of budget decisions are being made, that accessibility is at the fore.
Yeah, no, thanks very much, Convener, and it's a great question, and it's one of the aspects that we've been working very closely on. I remember doing budget scrutiny when I first came into this place, and you know, we would do an analysis of how many times women or disabled people were mentioned in a budget, and now we have much more deep and detailed data to pull on now from the improvements that we've been doing so far. You may remember that the Your Scotland, Your Finances is published alongside the last part of the budget, whereas this time we published it at the first point of the budget. So the budget was published on the 22nd and we published Your Scotland, Your Finances the very next day. And we're always looking to ways to improve all of that. I think, as I said, that it will be published alongside the draft budget going forward from there. Around about accessibility, easy reading, all of that, taking all of that into account. But we've taken a number of other aspects into account. And one of the things that we did do was created a lot of infographics. But from consultation with stakeholders, they felt that was not as accessible as it could be. So we now do a plain English, easy read version of that statement as well now. So hopefully those two measures, bringing it at the beginning and not at the end. Yeah. But we will also publish an updated one at the end so that people can see the distance that we have moved from the beginning of the budget process to the end of the budget process.
Okay, that's brilliant. Did you want to add anything, Rob, in terms of the wider work that's going on here?
No, I think the other point we would add would be around the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement, which I'm sure we'll explore, which also gets published alongside the draft budget. And that includes, as highlighted by witnesses last week, that includes extensive analysis, but also is presented in a short 30-page summary form to improve that accessibility over that particular aspect of the budget.
Yeah. Okay, that's great. It's language week, so I think my colleague Pam Gossel wants to just probe a little bit further into this area.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, Minister, and good morning. My question is around, in the back of what the Chair spoke about languages, obviously welcoming Language Week this week as well. There are no versions of the Equality and Fairer Budget Statement in other languages, and so many communities and individuals will be unable to see for themselves whether or not the Scottish Government is delivering on these priority areas. Has there been any community outreach work, initiatives, engagement that you've done to speak to these communities and about the language other than actually English?
Great question, because we always think about accessibility, about easy read, about BSL and about all of these, but other languages is also a key part of that. So we speak to stakeholders all the time. I'm not sure whether we picked up any huge issue about language accessibility during this process, but certainly in Languages Week we should be, and we will. So I'll go and have a look at what we produce and how we produce it. And we tend to use there's a great organisation, iTranslate, who a lot of is it iTranslate? Yeah, who a lot of the grassroots organisations access in order to get good translations of different documents. I think the budget documents in their technical way are pretty difficult to do that. But given that we now have the Fairer Scotland statement and the Your Scotland, Your Finances, we will go and have a look at how we can make that much, much more accessible, as you say.
I welcome the Minister if she does look at that, because obviously it's so diverse Scotland is, and many people are coming from different countries as well, and not everybody can speak the language English, and it's important that we set an example, you know, in the Scottish Parliament, that it's accessible to all, even those that don't speak it and understand how budget setting is done. So yeah. I welcome that.
Absolutely. We do fund a lot of minority ethnic organisations who do some work of their own in translating budgets out and translating consultations and everything else that comes from government that will be an interest to them. So the process will be there. I will just make sure that it's as sharp as it possibly can be.
And Pam Duncan-Gwansey.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. Thank you for setting out the priorities that the Government has and for sharing the information you have about the budget. There's a couple of things. I take the point about the Fairer Budget Statement being a huge improvement, and we have heard that from witnesses. But we did also hear witnesses say that it was still a bit of an art form to navigate. We heard statements like language like vague statements, no substance, hard to find the data in the annexes, insufficient clarity on the impact of decisions. So I do still worry that if people whose job it is to analyse the budget in terms of equalities are still struggling to navigate it in that sense, I do worry about the wider public in terms of accessibility. So would the Minister agree then that information is not quite there yet, that there is still quite a bit of work to do so that organisations and individuals can look at the budget and follow it through in a transparent and accountable way?
So, yeah, I heard some of those comments from witnesses last week as well. So also heard the positive progress that's been made as well. I think we view all of these documents and the processes that we go through as a continuous improvement process. So it's never actually ever going to be finished, because we want to always continually improve it in that. And every time we have a budget round, we learn new things, like bringing the Your Scotland, Your Finances, you know, statement at the beginning of the budget process, and then, you know, analysing that and publishing something at the end that tells you where we are. We hear a lot about language and jargon, but, you know, some budget documents are technical documents, and it's really hard to try and translate that into something that's much more readable and accessible. We do have an ongoing piece of work in how we link all of our pieces of work together to make it easier to navigate, and we do publish figures. We publish all level four figures with you know, the previous budget and the forthcoming budget, and the difference in that as well. So I know that some people are saying you can't track the pound through it, and where that gets spent, but we're taking lots of measures and to be able to do that. As I say, it's a continuous improvement project, and it's something we are working on every single time we go through a budget round. And we learned such a lot last year, because we had an RSR, an emergency budget, and then a budget process as well. So we learned so much from all of the quality of the work that we did that. And we've got a bit more work to do about joining some of that up. So I'll take that on board. That's a fair comment. But I would say, you know, we have came on leaps and bounds. There is ways to access budget documents that were never available to people before. The detail is there. And although it's 30 pages, which seems a hefty document in the grand scheme of things with all of the budget documents, 30-page summary, which is people have found to be really helpful. So we're looking at ways that we can use that and raise awareness of that much, much more effectively in order to address the issues that you raise.
I appreciate that, Minister. They follow the money all the way through so that people can understand what's happening. Is this budget line going up? Is it going down? How is it impacting on equality and human rights? We did hear consistently from witnesses that that's not an easy process. And in some cases, witnesses, including Audit Scotland, said that there was a gap between what the aspiration was and the reality of what was being delivered. Can I ask, can the Minister set out what conversations she's had with other government departments and other ministers with different portfolios about the impact of their budget lines on equality and human rights?
Yeah, absolutely. You will see from the evidence and the stage one debate last week that all committees raised issues around about equality and human rights, which is a huge step forward for when I chaired this committee. And you know, other committees would say that's not for us to look at, and they're all now looking at it. And that obviously gives us an excellent, although complex, picture of what's happening across all of the areas in government. Rob's here today because he's heading up our mainstreaming team, and we're working very closely with colleagues right across the whole of government. The Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement is a joint piece of work between me and the Finance Minister, but it's the DFM Deputy First Minister right now. So it's a joint piece of work. I'm at that at every step of the way, and obviously picking up a lot of the issues and concerns. I have to say, I've been really gratified over the past wee while, multiple budget evaluations over the last couple of years, to see other officials really picking up on the importance of ensuring that budget decisions that are made that have an impact on equality and human rights are made at the earliest stage. There's an understanding of that. We've worked with the Women's Budget Working Group to increase the capacity of officials right across the whole of government, and that's why Ben's with us today from Exchequer. We had a cracking roundtable event last week with the National Advisory Council for Women and Girls, and they were talking about gender competence and having some of the intersectional competence that we all need in order to read across what needs to be done. And Exchequer colleagues have undertaken all of that now. So when I see stuff come in that's usually just plain figures, budget stuff, I now see attached to that, much of the progress that's been made around about analysing and understanding if that pound spent there, what impact does it have here, and is that the impact we want to see? And I'm seeing that much better analysis of that. And that's why I think making sure that we link up all of our documents in a way that gives people a pathway to see through the budget and then see where that pound initiated there and how it's spent there really matters. And that's why I'm supported by officials from across government today to do that.
And are you confident that ministers and other portfolios are able to have the information and the data and the engagement that they need to recognise where their budget would have an impact on equalities?
Again, like, you know, the whole budget process, everything's a continuous improvement and we're learning all the time, and we learn some very key aspects from members of the National Advisory Council last week and how we can do this. You know, they came up with some ideas on how we can do this better, how we can work together to do it better. And I think that's the important part in all of this. I now have stuff coming into my box where I see other ministers are consulting very closely with stakeholders. So the DFM, for instance, met with the Women's Budget Group and in Gender Scotland to talk about the gendered aspects of the budget as well. So we're seeing all of that collaboration going across the board. And as I say, I don't make any decisions now without stakeholders sitting at the table.
OK, thank you. That's all my questions at this moment.
OK, and Rachel Hamilton.
Morning, Minister. Last week, Professor Hagan said that useful and important research came out alongside the budget. So she was... Most witnesses were complimentary at where we are so far, but they did highlight some gaps and deficiencies and holes, and I'm sure that you've looked at that evidence. She said that the resources are not well used in Parliament, the government, or externally, and I just wondered if you had an opinion on how that could be, those resources could be used better. And also, I wanted to get a better understanding of how the Scottish Government's policy thinking stems from the ERHBAG's group and how they draw recommendations to make improvements in the equalities budget.
Yeah, I heard some of that last week, and that's been a perennial problem. And the point was made, it's not just the government, it's the Parliament and it's other public authorities now, how we improve that whole process in order to ensure that those resources go to the right place. For my point of view, a lot of the work I'm doing around about equality and human rights with stakeholders and the funding that we provide them in order to do their work is outcome driven. It's what difference does it make to people actually in their everyday life. And a lot of that work now, especially around about delivering equally safe money, is about working in partnership. So a great example of that is the Saoirse project that I visited in Blantyre, where women are supported with domestic violence, with mental health and with addictions, but they go through one door and they tell their story once and all of those services click into place. And seeing resources being utilised in a way that has that holistic, successful outcome approach, it is really, really powerful. I'm not saying we're perfect, and the Delivering Equally Safe Fund is only about 8 months old now and we're still learning from that, and we published a six-month report on that, so I would commend that to you. But the other pieces of information that you were asking about the equality and human rights budget group. I can't remember, there's so many acronyms now that yes. So you know who I'm talking about. So one of the things that I did when I first came into government was to make the chair of that independent, so they become a bit of a critical friend of government, and they're not afraid. They're never even afraid to tell us what they think anyway, but they're able to be a bit more independent in their thoughts and all of this. And we've got a number of recommendations from the work that they've done over the past wee while. They've done pretty detailed analysis and some international comparators as well. I'm meeting with Angela Hagan in February in order to pick up those recommendations. We're working through those. I tend to look at recommendations, right, what can we achieve quickly, what's a bit more mid-term, and what are some of the long-term goals, and how do we work in partnership to meet that. I'll be meeting with Angela in February to discuss all of that. Happy to give the committee a much more detailed update on that, because we're not quite finished the work of analysing the recommendations yet. So I might be saying something that is maybe changed by the time we get to February.
And I think that's the area that I'm really interested in, Minister, is that We heard from Claire Gallagher, who said that the Scottish Government could improve its understanding of the evidence that it gets, from particularly from the recommendations. The Fraser Allender, similar vein of statement, it is not clear to the extent to which equalities considerations influence budget decisions. Also, it's about the how evidence is used and how robust analysis is used. So I wondered if, furthering on from Pam Duncan-Glancy's question, could you give the committee an insight into how the Scottish Government looks at the evidence, the research, and what analysis it does, and how that's conducted to understand how the budget will impact on human rights in different portfolios?
Yeah, so there's a huge piece of work that goes on in that. I think we've got about, is it 10 indicators that we use that produces hundreds if not thousands of pieces of rich data. And we use that to analyse both the impact of budget decisions, but more pushing towards using that to analyse the formulation of budget proposals. In that sense, we're shifting quite a bit towards that piece of work. One of the things that we picked up, and many of you have asked before, is about the quality of equality evidence and data. And we've obviously been working through a major piece of work of equality improvement data plans, so that the project set about commissioning a number of all of government, essentially each portfolio, to come up with an equality data improvement plan. They're currently in the process of doing that. So again, you know, once we're a bit closer to the completion, I think it's springtime this year. So the first quarter of this year, we should be in a position to give you more information about how we've used all of that data in order to not just analyse what difference we've made, but to look at how we use that to make decisions for the future. And that work is what essentially has informed the work that I've taken around about how funding and grant funding is distributed now. And that project that I mentioned is a perfect example of how can we get more for the small bits of money that we've got, but actually deliver a much better outcome for people.
So on the back of that, following that piece of work, will the Scottish Government commit to expanding the equality statement so that alongside the publication of the budget, so that there is an understanding, a better understanding, how the money follows the outcome?
Well, that's what we're working on, and that's that process of continuous improvement that we want to see, and you know, that route map that allows people to read the numerous layers of budget documents in a way that gets in the information that they want as well. We do have work to do, and I know Exchequer have been working on some aspects of this, because obviously, you know, these are the folks that are looking at, right, what's our top line, how much have we got to spend, where do we go, and I'm the person that's pushing it to say this is where you should spend it. So maybe Ben will give you the update as to the work that Exchequer's doing around about this.
So we are embedded in the Equality and Fair Scotland budget statement process, yeah. So it informs the budget process from start to finish. They work in tandem to make sure that the process follows through. We've, as part of that work, we've expanded the Annex A of the Equality and Fair Scotland budget statement, which provides an overview of how we've embedded equality and human rights analysis into budget decision making. I suppose, as the Minister's saying, it's a process of continuous improvement. We're working on updates in line with both the Equality Human Rights Budget Advisory Group and in line with the Open Government Partnership and our commitment to fiscal transparency and openness. Sorry, I'll put my teeth back in. And as part of that, we are actually looking at what can we do in a more public space to ensure that you can follow the money through, and we can provide a bit more detail to the committee on that, if that would be of use around particularly around the Open Government Partnership.
That would be very useful. Yes, thank you.
If you don't mind, Rob's going to come in and answer your question around about the analysis as well. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd just wanted to pick up your point about that analysis that's done at portfolio level.
Yeah.
I think it's important to highlight in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement process, it's not done from a central team, so each individual portfolio conducts analysis at an initial level first. And that initial analysis is what's outlined in Annex D, which is the very lengthy annex that witnesses referred to last week. So that's done at portfolio level, supported by the central EFSBS team. So we're not starting from either Exchequer or Equality and Human Rights doing analysis to portfolios. It is done in the portfolios initially, and that collates into the budget statement. And that, I think, leads to some of the points that are made about repetition. The length of that annex is because it's pulling together all of the work done by different portfolios. And rather than collating and summarising that, it's more transparent to publish that in full, which leads to that slightly difficult, very long, but underused, as Angela Hagen said, 200-page resource that publishes alongside it.
Yeah, thank you. And described maybe as siloed. But thank you for that. That's really interesting.
OK, thanks very much. And Maggie Chapman, please.
Thanks very much, Joe. Good morning, Minister. Thank you for being here and for what you've said already so far. I'm interested in exploring a couple of issues around accountability and, I suppose, tying up the connections between how decisions are made, what evidence is used to make those decisions, and how those are both linked forward to projected outcomes and tracked back to ensuring that actually those outcomes are what is delivered in terms of both equalities, objectives and rights realisation. Last week, Angela O'Hagan spoke of the need for greater clarity across the relationships between allocation, spend and outcomes, and greater clarity across the relationships between equalities, objectives and rights realisation. And Ali Hosey spoke also quite clearly about the need for evidence in that decision-making process. I wonder if you could just give us a little bit more detail on how in both the pre and during budget phases, and I know that it's a constant thing, isn't it? And these markers in the year where we publish certain papers and documents, but how do you ensure that we are getting consistency and acknowledgement across those different areas? And in your view, where are we not doing quite as well as we should be doing? Just a little question for you. Sorry.
As always, Maggie, thank you. So I think the Equality Fairer Scotland budget statement is our key primary tool in all of this. And obviously we have national outcomes, national performance framework, lots of other sort of regulatory things that fit into this, and the implications of public authorities if they don't uphold some of that. I think we have included more detail than ever in the Equality and Fairer Scotland budget statement. And Angela Hagen did say last week that 200-page document is underused, and that made me think about why is it underused. So I'm having some thinking about how we make it more, encourage more use of it in that sense. I think the points that both Ben and Rob made about how we use a detailed analysis and both now analysing what we have committed to and whether we have delivered those outcomes, but how we actually make decisions going forward and how we work across other parts of not just government but public authorities in order to realise that. I think one of the gaps, as you would put it, that I think that we are addressing in the Human Rights Bill is to bring about a much more clearer understanding of what people, government, both government, parliament and other public authorities' responsibilities are to ensuring that equality human rights outcomes are the best that they possibly can be. And if we look at areas where we spend money, so I know that you'll be very pleased, Maggie, to hear about the funding that's going to Clintorty in Aberdeenshire around about the Gypsy Traveller Accommodation Fund. Now, something as basic as accommodation has an impact on all equality and human rights outcomes for the Gypsy Traveller community in Scotland. To see that money going and then to go and see the actual finished products of how it's going to look. That's what's important to me, is to see those people realising their rights and understanding that they do have rights, because that's a community who felt as if they didn't have any rights. Mm-hmm. So we're working from a
a very tough position for them. But seeing where that money goes from this place to that place is incredibly important. And I think that's why when we do all the analysis, when we create all the documents, when we have all the, you know, the links that we want to have, it still concerns me that people are saying that it's underused and it's not usable. So that's something I want to see, because I want to see somebody be able to read that document and realise the outcome for Clinterty or, you know, a disabled people's organisation or whatever. You know, I want them to be able to see that, and I think that's where we've still got work to do, and that's where, if there's any, I'll say work to do rather than you know, gaps or anything. I think we're cognizant of that and mindful of what we need to do to get there.
No, I appreciate that, and it is, there is the clear intent from you to make those connections, and I think that was quite clear coming out of last week's session, was being able, the figure in this column, what does it mean for people on the ground? You know, everything in between is important, but actually it's the outcome that matters. I suppose following on from that, there's something around how, when you talk about meaningful and lasting change, there's something around how we don't only get the track from a figure in a spreadsheet to the outcome on the ground right, but we also make sure that everybody who needs to be involved in those decision-making processes is involved. And Rachel Hamilton mentioned the word siloing, and I think when you talk about the portfolio analysis, Rob, that you were talking about earlier, is there a, I understand why analysis is done in portfolios, because you have to choose some way to chunk it up and tease it apart and make sense of it. But how are we ensuring that we guard against the kind of right hand not knowing what the left hand's doing? For instance, when we're talking specifically about decision making leading to outcomes.
So I think two things there, Maggie. The point made about being siloed. So one of the points that was raised with us last week at the National Advisory Council for Women and Girls was about the homogenisation of protected characteristics.
Yes.
So you sit in a protected characteristic. We all know that usually a person is not just one protected character. They're a combination of them. And Rob made the point about how we do that analysis portfolio by portfolio. And if you read that way, that looks like it's siloed. But actually, when we draw on all of that, it becomes much more joined up and deals with that issue there. I think if we do, and we tend not to do this, but if it does look like we are looking at, you know, a homogenisation, you know, protected characteristic in one way that we're missing out, you know, in other ways, and we are doing a lot of work across government and especially in among some of the departments that maybe like Exchequer and others who would not maybe have ordinarily been involved in some of this, but looking at how do we develop capacity and competence, whether it's gendered, whether it's disability, whether it's equalities and human rights competence. And we've got, you know, experts right across the board now in this work, and that can only grow and become much better, I think. And I think that takes on that point about ensuring that we take an intersectional approach to everything that we do. So although the National Advisory Council for Women and Girls is Women and Girls, it also deals with disability, also deals with race, also deals with LGBTI, also deals, you know. So when we take this an intersectional view, we are taking a human rights and equalities approach, and it's just making sure that we've got the infrastructure, the capacity and the competence within our team in order to address that, pick out the issues, identify the gaps, and then come up with the plans in order to fix that. And that's what that continuous improvement vein is all about.
No, thanks, that's helpful. My final question, if I can, you'll be aware of conversations that we've had in this committee before around the need to actually identify what we mean by universal, the sort of minimum core, what we actually mean by the universal rights that we want to enshrine into Scots law. I suppose a question for ongoing work with you and your officials, as we do some of the work around minimum core, what are the points that would be necessary or important for us to bear in mind, particularly as we think about how that work can link to budget scrutiny and ensuring we get that connection, that accountability connection between what is your minimum basic level of rights and are those being delivered or not? Mm-hmm. Are the resources there to deliver those?
Yeah, well, I think we're a bit world-leading in some of this work and the proposals that are in our Human Rights Bill and a lot of the work that we've been doing with stakeholders. So we've funded a number of stakeholders' organisations to both look at the bill, look at the accessibility of the consultation, look at, you know, what does it mean? How do we make it plain language? How do we make rights real for people? So we're looking at all of that as far as core obligations goes, and a lot of that feedback's coming back about what people expect to be the minimum, you know, housing, food, you know, a job, the right to education, you know, whatever it is. So they're coming back with some of that detail. The consultation will be opened hopefully soon, and we, you know, I'll be hoping for many people who will be looking at that particular aspect, if not all of it, but that particular aspect, to come back with some of the ideas and resolutions that we need. We have some of that in train already. I think we know where we're going with all of this, but I want to hear, you know, quite conclusively from stakeholders what they expect and whether we can meet that expectation, because sometimes that's the tough part, is the aspirations there, the expectations there, and whether we can actually make it, you know, a line is sometimes the toughest part of all of that, and be assured that it's stakeholders who are the drivers for change in this who are working with us in order to ensure that those core obligations that we can put into our new act will deliver what they say in the tin. I think we should be quite proud, both as a parliament and this committee's work in making rights real and the work that they did in the previous session, but also you know, working together to realise those rights too.
OK, thank you. I'll leave it
there. OK, thank you. And Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and thank you for the evidence thus far. I've often thought that fiscal management can be a bit dry and a bit boring, but it's really not boring. This is quite exciting to be able to discuss how we follow the money and ensuring that when we're following the money, the outcomes that we're seeing are embedded in equalities and human rights. And it's a really exciting time. As you say, we're quite world-leading in a lot of this. And you hit the nail on the head when we're talking about, you know, that it's almost like an eternal progression. It probably will never be an end point, or nothing can be really set in stone as the world moves and as we realise you know, the needs of people and human rights, really, and the understanding that, particularly moving towards this wellbeing economy that we're really focusing on in Scotland. It's real crucial work, and it's particularly interesting at this committee, of course. Something that we were discussing last week really was that duty, accountability that public bodies have, local authorities, and making sure that their equalities duties aren't just an afterthought. I was saying, you know, I used to be a councillor, my other, in my previous life before I was here as an MSP, and often the equalities duties would be at the end of documents, and whether that was something that was perhaps done in practice, I don't know, but that's where they would sit, and then it would just seem that certain things were ticked off. How do we ensure that when it comes to these public bodies, that they are taking into account those core values and equalities does run through, you know, a thread in everything that they're doing?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I think human rights budgeting is a tool that government will use in order to realise some of that. And I think the well-being indicators that we have in the National Performance Framework is another example of that. And I recognise completely your characterisation of equalities and human rights being a bolt-on at the end of a project, you know, a box that gets ticked at the end. Oh, we've done that, so let's move on. That's not how we're seeing it now. And I think the work that we're doing around about the public sector equality duty, which we consulted on last year, we had some very, very strong evidence back from our stakeholders who I will be meeting with again soon to discuss some of the stronger proposals that they had in relation to what we were proposing in the consultation. So again, meeting expectation and realisation being really important. But I think the public sector equality duty, alongside our mainstreaming strategy, alongside national performance framework, alongside the equality budget statement, all have a key role to play in realising that the public sector equality duty, more so in a sense that part of the criticism is about how maybe vague some of that is, and we need more clarity around that. That will obviously need to work with the Human Rights Bill work that we are doing. So we are thinking of these things in tandem, not as two separate pieces. Mm-hmm. We're thinking that, well, it was all part of the jigsaw, as a characterisation I used earlier, and how we can use that to both put in stronger duties for public authorities in order to live up to the expectation mm-hmm. that we all want to see, but also to make that clearer. And I think given that the work of the public sector equality duty and the bill is still taking, you know, some years to do that, the reason for that is to work with public authorities to say this is what we want to achieve and this is how we'll achieve it and this is the way that you can achieve it as well. But the criticism from them is it's vague and it's not, you know, we don't understand okay. it. So that's the work that we're doing now in order to put much more clarity into what a public sector equality duty is, what a Scottish specific duty mm-hmm. is, and how actually how public authorities can use those tools in order to create better outcomes for the work that they do in their organisations.
Yeah, that's really helpful to know that perhaps they have been forthcoming and saying that it maybe hasn't been clear enough for them, because we can provide as many tools, you know, as we want, but it's how to use them, but also their priorities as well as local authorities. How do we ensure that those priorities are something that is of a core and what we really want to see nationwide in Scotland, but without overstepping our mark into their autonomy.
Yeah. Angela Hagan herself has done an amazing piece of work over the years speaking to local authorities and others around about human rights budgeting and gendered budgeting. So she's been, you know, working away doing that in the work that she does. And so does a number of other organisations like Making Right Reels, Rights Reels and other. Okay. Around about local authorities, so we had a human rights advisory bill meeting last week, so we meet very, very frequently right now. I chair that, and last week we had Councillor Maureen Chalmers, who's the new chair of the Wellbeing Board there, because we realised, you know, pretty quickly that actually local authorities are a huge and a key partner in all of this work, and so is COSLA, the work that they do. So although the Human Rights Bill will cut across many of those committees at COSLA level, Maureen's taken the lead on the work that we are doing around about the Human Rights Bill. So COSLA and the leaders are involved in this at these early development stages. Both to, you know, realise what will be their duty going forward, but to understand why that duty is important and the reason why we need it to be there and the reason why we need better outcomes for people who have, you know, some of the most deep and systemic structural inequalities that we currently we know about. So Maureen Chalmers was along at our first meeting last week. I asked her, I says, how did you feel that way? She went, oh my goodness, there's so much work here, but it will be incredibly important for all of the committees of COSLA. So I'm working on how we facilitate that with all the committees in COSLA as well. So that brings, you know, people in at the design stage, and therefore local authorities will hopefully understand what they need to be doing as they move forward. I'm sure they will.
That's great. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just to take the local authority funding issue a little bit further, we know that cuts to local authority budgets have squeezed council resources. We also know that they've exacerbated inequality across Scotland, particularly in housing and education and social care, which and community development areas that we know are really important for equality and human rights, and also the same is true for the third sector. And I was struck by your comments about a commitment to fair grant funding. Last week, the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice said to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, when I asked her what she would do to support third sector organisations to meet their commitments in terms of fair funding, I was quite disappointed that she basically said they would have to look at their assets and their resources, which effectively meant there wasn't going to be additional funding to help them meet those requirements. So how does that square with your ambitions to ensure that they can continue to deliver for equality and human rights?
So there is a couple of things there. Camp Secretary was absolutely right. It's up to local authorities how they spend their money. And if we started to tell them how to spend their money, we would get criticism. And if we don't tell them how to spend their money, we would have the same criticism. So
was about third sector, not local authorities. But I'll come back to local authorities as well.
But you mentioned the local authority budgets and the impact on third sector.
Yeah.
One of the things that we've looked at in this portfolio, and it's now been looked at across many portfolios now, is multi-year funding, is given that sustainability. And one piece of work we're doing right now around about the
violence against women sector mm-hmm. as a full review to look at how do we make that sector much more sustainable when you see local authorities maybe taking decisions that have mm-hmm. an impact on those services as mm-hmm. well, and maybe not for the better mm-hmm. In some cases. So we're looking at all of that. So we're very mindful of some of those issues mm-hmm. Around about how we fund have fairer funding sort of outcomes. One of the things is about how responsive we can be as well. So I've just announced just shortly £1 million for a winter package around about social isolation and loneliness. Some of that money, as you heard me, £200,000 going to Age Scotland because they produced that report at Christmas about keeping the doors open. And keeping the doors open was about small grassroots organisations who were getting bits of funding from different places, including local authorities and others, finding that really a tight squeeze because of the cost of living crisis. We've been able to respond to that. So fairer funding isn't just about sustainability in long term, it's about whether you can react. That's becoming much more tough, and it was incredibly tough to do that in this budget round. We've had to, you know, think about things really, really carefully about how we fund that. But we felt that was important to fund Age Scotland to do that piece of work to ensure that those organisations on the ground can keep going. Of course, our argument would be local governments get more money this year than they've had, although we all realise it is a very, very tight budget situation. We've got a finite budget that we have to work within as well, and that's really tough. When you make decisions, whether it's a local authority or a third sector organisation or whether indeed it's government, if you make decisions based on tackling the deepest and most challenging inequalities, then you make the best decisions for those outcomes, and that becomes tough when money starts to be squeezed very, very tightly indeed.
Mm. And are you confident that local authorities have done that?
I probably couldn't speak for local authorities, to be honest, and I wouldn't want to. I don't think that would be fair. Certainly, my ongoing work now with the new COSLA chairs, particularly of the Wellbeing Board, I'm seeing, it's absolutely superb work being done at local authority level. That's notwithstanding the challenges that everybody's facing right now around about budgets, around about the inflationary squeeze, and around about the cost of living that's impacting on everybody and every penny that they've got to spend. And I think we mostly do the best, as you know.
I think, like, the social care budgets, for example, and the education budgets are really, really, really squeezed. And we're hearing of disabled people struggling. We heard from People First that the people that they work with are having to choose whether to go and pay a bill, get the shopping, or have a bath or a shower. Those are choices that don't result in equality and human rights being the reality. And yesterday I met with organisations working in autism, and some of the experiences that they're having in the education sector, and having to try and find support for people when they come out of school and into transitions. It's just really difficult because those services either aren't there or the money isn't available for them. What conversations have you had with the Minister for Social Care, the Cabinet Secretary for Education and COSLA on the implications for some of those settlements for local authorities and how that impacts on equality and human rights? Because ultimately it is about specifics in those areas as opposed to the broader £48 million that's going into sort of the structural inequality funding.
Okay. I think it's for other ministers to respond to the specifics, and we can get your response on all of that. I think on the wider point that you make about the £48 million that I've got to spend and try and be as creative as I possibly can with that, and the difference that we make with that, particularly around about disabled people's organisations that you've just mentioned. Mm-hmm. GDA, who you'll know very well, Pam, and you'll know the power of Tressa and how influential and insistent that she is, absolutely rightly so, because she's tackling these decisions every single day. Cabinet Secretary attended their conference last week and heard firsthand all of those challenges you just talked about, heating or eating, nutritious foods, all of that, and some of the issues that they face. Some, positivity around about some of the support that we've put in place here and some of the support we've put in place around about supporting the organisations that support people as well and getting them the right advice. So on the back of that, last week we've had a deeper discussion about the challenges, particular challenges, the cost of being a disabled person in the UK right now, and the additional cost that merits against you know, a family, a household, and how they cope through a really challenging situation. And we're working on doing some of that. The reports that GDA published, you know, the one that was we're all in the same storm, but yep, we're not in the same boat type report that they did. Really powerful stuff in there. So we're again looking at what more we can do. A big part of it is the reserved benefit situation and where we are with some of that, and hopefully some of that being alleviated as people transfer over to adult disability payment, child disability payment, you know, warmer homes, all of that stuff. It's a whole package. Mm. So I'm now doing a bit of work in looking at all of that, and that runs alongside in tandem with the developing of our new disability strategy, which we're working with stakeholders on. So on the specifics that you mentioned there, I'll get you updates from those cabinet secretaries. But on the wider proposals, I'll come back to you with where we have got around about the development of the new strategy, but taking into account the real and today impact of the cost of living on disabled people. And I think the points you made about autism and the education system and transitions are not lost on us at all. You're doing great work yourself in this area. I've just read some of your stuff in the last week around about the analysis of your consultation. And there's a recognition here that there's more we can do here, and government are looking at how we can work together on that.
Thank you, I appreciate that. I have one further question, if that's okay. You mentioned the cost of living and the extra costs associated with being a disabled person. Just because you've mentioned it, has the government considered whether or not they could update the research on the extra costs of being a disabled person? I think Scope, the most recent research was done by Scope in 2018. It would be maybe quite timely to do that in Scotland to look at what those extra costs are.
I think we are, but I'll go and double check that, Pammy, and get back to you with a more substantive answer. I think the work that we are doing around about the development of the new strategy is with stakeholders, and some of the questions around about that is up to date analysis. So some of that work was done pre-pandemic, mm-hmm, pre-cost of living. You know, we're in a different environment now, and it's about how do we. Some of it's about getting quick answers, mm-hmm, as well, and quick resolutions as well. So let me go back and look at all of that to ensure that we're updating that, okay, that data as well.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Fulton MacGregor, please.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the Minister and your officials. Good to have you here, and appreciated your responses so far, Minister. I was going to ask about participation. Now, I know you've covered this a wee bit in the opening statement and as you've answered the other questions, because there is quite a lot of overlap here, but so I'm wondering if you can, let us know what the government are doing proactively to improve capacity around public participation. And what I mean by that is helping people to understand exactly the impact that spending decisions will have in their own lives.
Yeah, I think you'll have seen from the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group's recommendations that they state that public participation is a key part of that, and is a said a few times, I don't make very many decisions in my portfolio at all without having stakeholders and public participation at the heart of that. And I think the integration of those thoughts, experiences and understanding is incredibly important for us to do that. I think we recognise that there is more work to be done. And if we look at Social Security Scotland as an example and how we used lived experience boards, we use lived experience boards and panels and groups and advisory groups across the whole of government now in that way, which allows us to have at the heart of government people with their absolute lived experience. The challenge is getting that back out into wider networks, and some of the work that I do around this is using those networks to get that information out. So, you'll have organisations, you know, like SEMVO. You had SEMVO in front of you last week, or BMIS, or the GDA or others, who will have huge networks. The Older People Strategic Action Forum, my goodness, have they got a massive network. And it's about how we feed that information back out through to those people. So one of the criticisms that we've had recently is that some of these organisations and the people that are involved in it have a consultation overload. So we had to think a bit about how we time consultations for specific groups in order to get the maximum participation for them to do that. So again, it's always about continuous improvement. We're always asking people, right, you've just taken part in this piece of work to tell us your experience here, and we've used it in this way. What could we have done to make it better? And we're working on all of that as we move forward. So, but as I say, participation is a key aspect here, whether it's in budgeting decisions, whether it's local budget decisions. I've got a great, local group in my constituency that do participatory budget and give out micro-grants, and my goodness, what a difference they've been able to make in local communities with that, because the folk who are living in those streets and villages and towns are saying this is what we need, and this is how much we need to do it, and this is the difference we can make with it. And I think that's very, very important in how we track, again, that pound. So it's not just about saying, oh, you're at the table, thanks very much for your comments and goodbye. It's, an ongoing relationship that allows us to understand what the next steps are. And some of the bits of legislation I'm working on right now, so for instance, the conversion practices advisory group and the interim governance group for race and tackling racism. Both of those groups are still working with us as we move forward, so we're going back and forward all the time and checking to make sure that participation part of it is not just lip service, it's actual commitment to make sure that those voices and those people are at the heart of that.
In your own commitment in this area, I don't think you've ever been outed, Minister, so you don't mind me saying that. And I was on this committee with you when you were chair as well, so and I know it's something that you've always been very passionate about. So moving on from that, in terms of participation, and probably a wee bit on Pam Duncan Lancy's point, Angela O'Hagan actually said to us last week that, that's a quote, both the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government could do more to raise public awareness of Scotland's finances. And I wanted to ask a bit about that, because it's a thing, it's something that's been on my mind a wee bit, even maybe came out a wee bit in the exchange between yourself and Pam Duncan Lancy a minute ago. A lot of times when we're involved in politics, it depends what political party you follow, but where the state of the finances, either in Scotland or in the UK. But a lot of people don't follow politics, and or they maybe vote, but they don't maybe follow on social media, etc. So how can we work together? Because I suppose there's always an element of you can say figures either way and turn them round or whatever, but how can we all work together, not just the Scottish Government, but parties across the Parliament, to make sure that the public actually understand the current situation and the impact and how that's affecting decision making around budget and the impact in people's lives? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
and always
yeah.
work together and almost have a collective responsibility around that. Instead of, what we sometimes see in the chamber, which we're all guilty of, I suppose, is a particular narrative.
Yeah. No, it's a great point, and this committee has done a lot of work in bringing that forward, and I think, making the Parliament a human rights guarantor is a key aspect of that, because it's a people's Parliament, and therefore, their Parliament are speaking with one voice around about guaranteeing people's human rights in Scotland is really important. The government take that view as well. And you might have picked up my comments earlier about recognising that all of the committees, 12 I think, raised issues around about human rights and equalities budget and their work, which is a huge shift from where we were before. We were very siloed as committees before. So to see that, I think it shows the Parliament and its committees doing that work. There. You made a really key point, and it's one of the things that always sticks in my head as Eleanor Roosevelt quote is, human rights are for people in small places close to home. And when something has an impact on an individual, that's when they realise, maybe where the decision is made or, the process that went through to get there. And they almost reverse engineer from their perspective back to, who takes the key decisions here and how much money was spent on it and why was I not recognised in this? And that's some of the work that I think we are doing around about creating an environment where we make it as plain and as accessible as possible when it comes to budget processes. But any really parliamentary process, lots of folk don't understand the steps that are taken to get to it, and many do. I think, given the amount of engagement work I do out there, I'm always blown away by the competence, the confidence and the understanding of the general population, in a sense, around about what they see as a good outcome. And that's about where's my council tax money spent, where's my tax money spent, where's this spent, where's that spent, and how we articulate that. And I think we've all got a job to articulate, you know, the positivity in that, but also recognise the challenges and take those on board. And it's why that point about participation of stakeholders is incredibly important, because that gives us a two-way street in order to share information out and to get information back. And that hopefully addresses that issue of what's important to an individual in their community in a small place close to home.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Pam Grossell, please.
Thank you, Chair. While I welcome some of the work involving women that the Scottish Government are doing that the Minister mentioned today, however, we can't ignore the issues that we've heard in evidence in this committee. In the pre-budget scrutiny last year, we learned from Susan McKellar that women's organisations had asked to be involved in the budget process in more depth and were told no because of time constraints around the budget. We then learned from Professor Angela O'Hagan in the post-budget scrutiny just last week that women were not heard in the budget setting process. Minister, after hearing this evidence in this committee from last year and this year, I'm extremely worried. Is the Scottish Government ignoring women?
I'm going to say no, Pam. Of course, I'm going to say no. And you may not have picked up the point I made earlier about the Deputy First Minister meeting with the Women's Budget Working Group and in gender as part of the budget process. So the women's voices were there. And if you get a chance, even 5 minutes, to spend any time in the National Advisory Council for Women and Girls, you will see they are not silent in their both influence and impact on government and the work that they do. They're just about to produce their next set of recommendations. And many of the recommendations is around about where women are seen and where they're consulted and how they're consulted. And in many ways, that's the work that we're improving as well. So we're you know, absolutely clear that women's voices are at the heart of this. I think, you know, we've got a gender balanced cabinet, so those women's voices around that table who are not shy about you know, raising those voices when they need to. But I don't see that characterisation. I see a progress from it, absolutely, but I don't see the characterisation that women's voices were not heard, because they absolutely were. And I can give you that commitment and certainly the evidence to justify that position.
Thank you, Minister, for that response. But obviously we in this committee listen to evidence, what comes before us. And because that evidence was given to us last year, and, you know, I'm a big supporter of women, just like many people in this parliament. And I just feel, why would something be brought up last year and then I probed on it just last week again with Dr. Angela? And Dr. Angela made it very, very clear. If you get a chance to listen to her response, she was actually very articulate in delivering her response and quite detailed as well. So, you know, I would hope that the Minister welcomes that, to go and speak to Dr. Angela and speak to Susan McKellar and see what the issues are, even though I did say in the beginning I welcome the work you're doing. But I feel that if these people are voicing it in our committee here, and we are the people's parliament, as you said, we do really need to be listening to other people to see why they're thinking that the women have not been listened to.
OK, I would say we are. I'm meeting with Angela in February, so I'll pick up this point with her, and I'll arrange to meet with Susan McKellar to pick up the point with her as well. Angela O'Hagan is an amazing champion for women's rights. She's always going to try and push both this parliament and this government much, much further than we're currently at. We welcome that. It's a good challenge to take on. It's not an easy challenge to take on in some respects, but it's a good challenge to take on, and that's why she is in the position she's in. I'm really grateful to offer her an extension of her position as the chair of the Equality Human Rights Budget Working Group, and to create the independence of the chair. So she's, you know, she uses that to great effect, and I'm always in awe of Angela and the work that she does. I will be meeting with her in February. I'll pick up those points. I'll pick up the points with Susan McKellar, but I'll also pay tribute to Angela and her undiminished push to make this government work better. And I welcome that with a smile.
Sorry, Chair, can I just add one more question, if it's possible? It's outside the topic I've spoke about. I was contacted by a BAME women's organisation that I won't mention, and that they've highlighted that they feel, as you know, there is a lot of work going through with, basically, and a lot of issues when it comes to domestic violence. And you talked about a lot of that stuff earlier on. Now, I was contacted to say that funding has been cut and that not all the organisations get fair funding, and sometimes some of them deliver in the most areas that you can't reach. And I've seen that myself going out in those communities. And so is there anything that you can highlight? I mean, I will have a meeting with them and come back to you further with that. But is there anything you're aware of there that suddenly, you know, last week funding was cut and they got funding issues from the government, what the money you've given out to some of the BAME communities?
Well, I've not got open funding rounds right now, so I don't know if it was from my portfolio. But give me the details. And
it was to do with violence and equality.
It might have come from a different part of government. Give me the details and I'll look at it. I did have a visit with Shakti, and I'll obviously speak to Sahelia and other women's organisations quite often, and completely understand those issues around about multiple characteristics and in looking at that. But get me the details, Pam, and I will look at it. I won't try and give you something off the top of my head until I know the details, and we can address it head on.
OK, I think that has concluded the kind of budget part of our meetings, but there was one or two issues that maybe we want to just follow up on. We'll see if other members, some of the issues you've covered. So you mentioned, particularly in relation to your answering Fulton McGregor, I think it was, around the conversion practices working group, and obviously this is an area the committee takes a very close interest on. The committee were very clear when we produced our report that we need this to move forward at pace. So it'd be good to get an update in terms of what timings are looking like, just to confirm that things were still expecting the bill by the end of this year. And I guess the other thing we were very clear about was that the legislation in Scotland needs to be inclusive of all, so trans-inclusive in particular, and we've seen a shift in the UK government towards that position, which I guess just good to hear your comment on that. And I guess the other area where we were very clear on is that there shouldn't be loopholes and that it's not possible to consent to what is effectively torture. And I guess that's an area where it looks like there is still a disparity between the Scottish position and the UK government's position. So maybe if you want to just, if there's anything you could comment around that, whether there's any discussions with UK government, whether that's an area you think that they might be also moving on as well to be more aligned with the views expressed by this committee and this parliament.
Yeah. No, thanks, convener. First up, really welcome the UK bill and welcome that covers all areas. In discussion right now about how the bills maybe look differently, so we've got officials are working with, excuse me a second, UK government officials on both our approaches. I think it's important to do that, and we were having, some of those conversations. I really welcome the UK government's commitment to consult on their principles around about the bill, and we'll be looking at them with interest. It's a tricky area, as we know. Other parts of the world who have done this, we're looking at what the same way that the committee did, and how they have created a proposed bill that covers as much as possible everything we want it to cover. So we're doing all of that. We're on target to meet the deadline of introducing the bill by the end of 2023. There is a huge bit. Actually, I've got an update this afternoon on where we are. We are at the drafting point of the consultation and just working through what that means now. And I will have obviously committed to give the committee regular updates on that, and I'll do that once we move by this next step. We decided to have a good look at what the UK government's proposing, so we're taking a bit of time to do that and come back to you with that then. But we're on target and it's looking good.
OK, thank you. I'm just looking around, were there any other members keen to pick up on? Maggie?
Thanks very much,
Joe, just a quick question, and apologies if I missed it earlier. On the regulations that the Scottish Government has been talking about introducing around public sector equality duty, can you just give us a bit of an update of where we are with that and how you see that going forward over the next 2 years? Because I know we want those regulations actually in operation in 2025.
You'll know the consultation closed in around about autumn time. I remember all the timelines in my head.
Yeah.
And we had a really helpful, if not challenging, letter from a number of organisations who said, we think this doesn't go far enough. So we're at the stage of consulting and talking to them about that right now to inform the next steps as well. But the timetable for that, I'm not wrong in saying, is on schedule as well. So it's sort of on the schedule. We can see if I can share the schedule with you. But we are looking at the analysis of the consultation and then, you know, the challenge from civil society organisations who want us to be stronger and go further.
Okay.
So we're working on that now.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Pam DG, please.
Thank you, and I appreciate both of those updates. That's really helpful. Thanks, Minister. The UK Government, you'll be aware, was due to publish its report on the Convention on the Elimination of Race Discrimination in 2020 as part of the Universal Periodic Review, but that was delayed until 2022, I think, was the most recent update from the UK Government about the report they're drafting. Can you tell the committee about how involved you've been with that particular report and whether or not the Scottish Government have engaged in that process?
So we had our own piece of work going on from the expert reference group in COVID and ethnicity, now the interim governance group on race and racism, and the work towards the observatory. So we were already on a pathway of doing some of that anyway. On the UPR in particular, you'll know that the recommendations were issued by the UN in November, I think.
Mm-hmm.
We're currently in the process of working through those ones that are impacting us and working with the UK government and how we inform that. Of course, we get a word limit on mm-hmm. what we can contribute to that, so we always try to make it as concise as possible. So that's a piece of work that we are working on and preparing right now. What we tend to do, and we will do in this case, will be to publish our own Scottish-specific statement as well, and that gives much more detail about the areas that we are working on in regards to the recommendations from the UPR. Some of the recommendations to the UK government were we were a bit further ahead than maybe England and Wales and some of that, so we obviously want to highlight some of that, but working very closely with our colleagues at Westminster to both mutually support the work that we are doing, but also to ensure that Scotland's voice is heard when that report goes back to the committee, I think, in the spring this year, March, I think.
That's helpful. Do you know when the Scottish Government will start engaging organisations in that report? Or are you already doing that?
Well, we're doing some of that through, but let me get you some more info on how we're doing that specifically with the UPR.
Okay, good question. Thanks very much. That's all.
Okay, thanks very much. I've no further indications. So that brings us to the end of the session. I thank the Minister and your officials for attending. We'll now move into private session for the remainder of the meeting. Thank you.